Airsoft. A global battle sport based on the use of replica weapons that fire low-velocity plastic ammunition. Gaining in popularity for over 50 years, I started to ask myself, where did Airsoft come from? Well, if you do a skim dive, you'll see that Airsoft was created by this man, Ichiro Nagata, in Japan in the 1970s. And in saying this, you'd be right, sort of. In the same way that you'd be correct in saying that the Wright brothers invented the airplane. When in reality, it's a little bit more complicated than that. You see, Ichiro didn't just wake up one day and say, "Airsoft, yeah, I'm gonna make that." No, if you want to track the true origins of Airsoft, you're going to need to follow the global events and technological advancements that brought us to what we know as Airsoft today. So without further ado, let's hop right in. Our story begins over 150 years ago, in a little place called America, with this man, Clarence Hamilton. You see, Clarence was a watchmaker and a tinkerer by nature. And one day, he got it into his mind that he wanted to build an all-metal, spring-powered air rifle that used round shot, in order to teach children proper firearm use. Now, it's important to say that air rifles had existed for literally hundreds of years before this, as an alternative to flintlock weapons, which would be susceptible to wet weather conditions. But what makes this man special is this. He showed his gun to a buddy of his who happened to be a windmill manufacturer. This man took one shot with this rifle and said, "Whoa, that's a Daisy." And long story short, the Daisy Air Rifle Company was born, where they've developed literally hundreds of groundbreaking designs for air rifles, but none more popular than their flagship, the Red Ryder Daisy Rifle. Now, what makes this gun so special was the marketing. You see, Red Ryder isn't just a name they came up with off the top of their head. It was actually the name of a main character in a dime novel called, you guessed it, Red Ryder. This was marketing genius, and an idea that would be repeated in the future. Now, I know what you're thinking. This isn't an airsoft gun, this is a BB gun. But I would put it to you, if you're trying to tell me that kids back then weren't having mad BB battles after they were done working in the shoe factory or whatever the fuck they were doing, then I would say you're probably wrong. Otherwise, why would they put this disclaimer on the front of the issue? Be sure to be safe. Twink. Anyways, fast forward 60 years of kids shooting their fucking eyes out, and the next big thing in Airsoft happens. World War II ends with the bombing of Nagasaki and Hiroshima. And two important things happen in this moment. One is that America occupies Japan. We're gonna come back to that later. The next thing that happens, all the American troops go home and start f***ing. And 9 months later, guess what started happening? With the baby boom in full swing, all these babies started popping up everywhere. And babies need toys. That's when these two guys came in. Their names were Matt Mattson and Elliot Handler. And these two guys saw these babies and said, "Okay, boomers, we got you." And founded Mattel Toys in 1945. Now, Mattel is known for a lot of different things. Among them are Barbie, Hot Wheels, and they even sponsored a small-time TV show called The Mickey Mouse Club. But most importantly, they made guns. Sort of. Cap guns. Cap guns were all the rage in the late 40s, early 50s, and into the 60s. With their realistic metal construction, their loud popping action, and occasionally a plastic projectile would fly out at the end, which was, quite nice. The pinnacle of this at the time being the Dick Tracy Snub-Nose 357 Gel Cap Shooter, which was marketed as a must-have for any reader of the most popular comic book in America of the time. I wonder where I've seen that idea before. See, cap shooters were a rudimentary way to fling a small plastic projectile harmlessly through the air, usually with piss-poor accuracy. But as far as realism goes, it couldn't be beat. Now, they started out with revolvers, and eventually shell-ejecting versions of cap guns hit the market. Cap gun popularity was at an all-time high. When you see old commercials trying to market cap guns to kids, you can really see the similarity between this and what a lot of people do today with airsoft guns. With popularity of toy guns at an all-time high, you see a lot of smaller companies trying to cash in on that popularity boom. And at the same time, we start to see our very first airsoft gun. Sort of. The spring-powered Rayline Zebra 2 soft pellet pistol, which, believe it or not, is based on a real gun, the Whitney Wolverine Space Age Aluminum 22 caliber semi-auto pistol, which was only made for 1 year. So technically, this is the first Springer airsoft pistol, even though it didn't use an air piston, it just uses a spring, which really limited its range. But you know what? It's the first gun to use 6mm plastic BBs. So, respect to you, Rayline Zebra 2. You're an airsoft gun in my book. So while this is all going down in America, back over in Japan, US has just occupied it. The cultural shock of post-war Japan being flooded with hundreds of thousands of Americans pumping American pop culture into this country that has to basically rebuild its self-identity from a fucking empire of ninjas and samurai that have lived and breathed war for literally centuries into a peaceful trade nation. So how do you do that? Well, you take away their guns and their swords, of course. So, new laws were put in place, limiting ownership of projectile weapons and the materials they could be made of. Now, there's two facts we're dealing with here. First, is that gun enthusiasts do not give up their hobby lightly. And second, is that Japanese ingenuity is not to be underestimated. Now, in Japan, martial prowess is coveted very highly, and with gun enthusiasts unable to partake in their passion, they turned to the hobby model toy community. There, they found cap guns, classified as model guns. Primarily made of plastics and zinc-based metals, it was the only legal way to get the firearm experience in Japan. At first, model guns were imported from the US from companies like Mattel and distributed by companies like Japan Model Gun Collection Association, which would later start modifying the cap guns to make them more realistic, until they finally said, we can do better. They changed the name of the company to MGC and released their first in-house, fully Japanese model gun, the Walter VP2 Ignition model with innovative slide action design. It was a hit, and the company and the hobby exploded. And meanwhile in the background, a startup company is making toy airplanes and plastic dinosaurs. The name of that company is Tokyo Marui. So fast forward to 1977, and a couple of important things happen. First, that small toy company that I mentioned, well, it blew up in size, so they purchased a new factory so they could produce more bobbleheads and other precision plastic toys. Second, new regulations just got put into place on the gun law, prohibiting materials that can be used for model guns. And needless to say, the industry took a hit in Japan. Plastic guns just didn't feel as realistic. It was around this time when proto-soft air shell-ejecting Springers started showing up on the market, from companies like Daisy. the defining feature being an unwieldy cocking mechanism where the cylinder pops out the back, as well as the ammunition being a plastic BB, usually ranging from about 5mm to 7mm, depending on what company or what brand you're using. At this point in time in the model gun community, the main mode of competitions was a quick draw competition, where you would see how quickly you could draw your weapon and fire it at a target. At the same time, a magazine called Combat Magazine was just published in Japan, where it had an article detailing a sport that people were playing in America called Survival Game, where you would use paint markers and the last man standing wins. Sounds kind of familiar, doesn't it? Once the Japanese model gun enthusiasts got a hold of this information, they were inspired. And it wasn't long before they were using their shell-ejecting soft air guns to create survival games of their own, called Subaibaro Gimu. Now, if you've ever had a Springer airsoft battle, you know they can be lots of fun. But you should also know that if you ever go against somebody with a semi-automatic or an automatic weapon, you're going to be at a distinct disadvantage. And this is a fact that one particular man was eager to take advantage of. So Ichiro looked at the technology around him, and he decided to go to work and create his own weird amalgamation of a battle machine. His result? The first airsoft gas blowback ever. He called it a soft air gun because it utilized Freon silicone gas tubes from an airbrush instead of the standard CO2 canisters, which resulted in a much lower muzzle velocity, which fell well within the strict Japanese regulations. Now, as soon as these precision soft air guns hit the market, they were a hit. Instantly, you could see the difference between a model gun and a soft air gun. The accuracy, non-comparable. The range, same. Soft air was just better, especially for the growing popularity in the survival game mode. But there was just one problem. They were expensive. See, this model that I showed you right here, this would have sold for about $300 at the time, maybe a little more even, which doesn't sound like much by modern airsoft standards, but when you calculate for inflation, that's over $2,000 for this pistol. That's a lot of cheddar. With the booming popularity of airsoft in Japan and the exorbitantly high prices of the guns, it was clear that there was a need in the market for a cheap, reliable airsoft gun. In steps Tokyo Marui with their very first airsoft pistol. With an entire factory devoted to precision plastic molding and an eye for niche markets, they hopped right on the bandwagon, producing this Luger P08, which didn't have a hop-up, only held about 16 BBs and was spring-powered. Accuracy was a little bit wanting, but the real kicker was the price. It came in at $15. It was an instant hit. At this point in time, airsoft gun companies were popping up all over Japan, and a lot of the old model gun companies could see the writing on the wall and knew it was time to make the switch. Among them, the Japanese Model Gun Collectors Association, now MGC, designed their first gas blowback airsoft pistol, the Browning semi-automatic. Another former model gun company named LS, who used to specialize in the manufacturing and distribution of model gun kits, which you could receive in pieces and assemble at home, well, they saw an opportunity. So they switched over to airsoft guns and started selling model airsoft gun kits that you could buy and assemble at your own home. And the beauty of this was that they could sell internationally. And thus, airsoft was introduced in the world. And not long after, Tokyo Marui designed their first automatic electric gun, the FAMAS. With innovative technology like an electro-pneumatic gearbox as well as hop-up, we finally get to see airsoft as we know it today. And the rest is history.